long, tiring day. You've had your work schedule as well as giving us time. And yet you look so energetic and enthusiastic. So I think for the audience, as far as for my personal benefit, I should ask you about your fitness regime.
Very, very important for me. I'm fortunate I have a great deal of support in both back at home and at work, with the team taking care of most emergencies and calling me at the point when I'm absolutely required for a transplant.
Right.
Likewise at work, my wife focuses entirely on my health, other than her professional responsibilities. So right. You know, I'm very fortunate to have an incredible homemaker.
Right.
Who's been so supportive. I've always been a fitness freak, and I've exercised all my life. I've been a very active sportsman in both in medical school and my school days. So it just continued. When you are in your formative years of your life, you're working really hard professionally, and then you kind of start beginning to succeed professionally.
Yep.
You have a very small interval where you can also be physically fit, and you can continue to be at the peak of your powers as far as your training is concerned.
Right.
So as we get better only when we get older. You know, cardiac surgeons are like old wine.
You know,
they mature with time. So it's roughly around 40 or 45 years of age that you have learned enough to be able to practice your craft with a great deal of precision and make all those very critical decisions. Now from 45 or maybe late 40s, you have only probably 10 or 12 years where your body starts failing. The only thing you can maximize, not just as a responsibility to your patients, because patients trust you when you're more experienced.
Right.
So if you're 60 and you're a practicing surgeon, patients will continue to trust you because you're experienced and you're famous.
Right.
But if your body is failing, you will start making flawed decisions.
Mm-hmm.
You would possibly not be able to consistently operate for long hours with the same deal of precision and the same deal of effort. So I think investing in health is a major, major investment. So I spend an hour and a half every day in the morning on my fitness at the gym, and I think it helps.
Right, doctor, we've got a sweet ride back home. So let's talk about your interests in driving and cars and so on.
Yeah, everyone loves cars. So,
right.
I mean, I'm no different. But yes, I'm a very safe driver. I like a vehicle that has a lot of power under the hood.
Okay.
But I never, almost never, exercise the use of that power. I just like a powerful vehicle simply because it feels that you're controlling a lot of horsepower in your arms, but you still have a lot of restraint.
Right.
So that's how I think. That's a philosophy that I have as a person also, that a physician has great deal of power, not just over his own actions, but also over what he does and human life.
Right.
So that comes with a great deal of responsibility, and I think this is just an analogy that I would like to use. That
right, so I see this, the surgeon and the person, it's a great mix of qualities that you take from the surgical life into your personal life, and from your personal life into your surgical life.
A sense of fulfillment just doesn't come from what you do. I think it also comes from appreciating everything that is around you.
Right. And nature plays
it's a huge role. I mean,
right. You've
seen the way we love to live in a place that is absolutely so green.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's what we're going to see once we drive in home.
You'll see that, and that actually is a very grounding influence. You know, I mean, we see all these very modern buildings, and we see all this very contemporary kind of decor.
Mm-hmm.
We've stuck to our roots. We've stuck to our traditions. My wife is a North Indian, but she's beautifully melded into whatever traditions we have anywhere that we live.
Right.
So she's very, very flexible, and we lead a very quiet life. We are not very socially active, literally inactive, I would say.
Piece of the same pod kind?
Yeah,
okay.
Sure. I think even our star signs are very compatible.
Okay.
And she's a very quiet, private kind of person, so have I.
Okay.
Turned out largely to be.
Okay.
I mean, I used to be I wouldn't call myself an extrovert. I was always an introvert.
Right.
But, you know, you have this masquerade of an extrovert. You know, you pretend in your younger days. When you're surrounded by all your friends, and you know, you tend to be a little you know, kind of more, what would I say, a social kind of person.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not really much of what I am.
Right.
I've realized increasingly that I am a pretty private person in that sense. Yeah.
So you've mentioned your wife quite a number of times. So where did you guys actually meet, and let's hear about that, because we are talking this episode to a heart surgeon. So we should talk about the matters of heart.
She's probably the first person, the first female, I mean the first person from the opposite sex that I learned to know well.
Uh-huh.
And I was immediately attracted to her because she's a very simple person.
Right.
Not just extremely attractive to look at. Mm-hmm. She's an amazingly simple person, and though she came from a very, very up class background,
mm-hmm.
She was very quiet and not a loud person.
Mm-hmm.
And those are things that actually really attracted me to her. You know, she was not this kind of over. Reacting, you know, kind of very, very. She always had those features of somebody who would become a wonderful partner. The country, obviously, it was quite unusual.
Right.
But that was not the flavor of the day, if I may use that term.
So, and how was it from her end? Was it a long courtship?
Yeah, it was not a very long courtship. I think she kind of. Accepted right from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when she started actually more than the affection, I think it was her support and her encouragement, you know.
Right.
That helped me through all those very difficult times. I can't even think about the struggle that she went through in all
somehow
those days.
It comes so inherently to them, and somehow it doesn't come so inherently to us.
Yeah, we are a little selfish as we are men, but you know, I mean, I also do understand that, you know, if your wife has taken so much of a responsibility to get you where you are early on in your life, as you take over that mantle when you start succeeding,
right?
You know, unfortunately, it generally is seen as more misogynistic or probably a male dominant kind of a family.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is a very wrong,
so it's
very
almost
skewed
an
way.
Organic choice which happens.
That's right, it is a choice that happens, and you decide just to work together because, you know, you have a family to look after.
Right.
Your children become your priority after some time. My wife now spends a lot of time other than you know, her professional responsibilities to also ensure that, you know, my son makes the right choices, that he's in the right state of health. We're looking forward to his marriage very shortly, hopefully. We don't know when, but in a brief period of time from now, his graduation from graduate school. I mean, he would probably be going to the US in the next couple of months, probably a year, to pursue his graduate education. So I mean, you have so many things to do, and then to look after me, my pet, and a responsibility towards her parents and my parents. I don't think it's easy, you know. I mean, it's simpler for me.
Mm-hmm.
I just got to do my job, come home, I get my warm meal, and then, you know, that's about it. I just go off to sleep. And
having just left the environs of the hospital, how different a person you are now as we get home.
Yeah.
So this is fascinating. So it's almost like you've switched off from your professional responsibilities. Now it's time to head home. It's fascinating.
It's always a fulfilling day once you've had a hard day at work, and you know, and then now you can kind of partly switch off and think of a few other things that you know, possibly need relevance and need some kind of
attention. Maybe.
So that's Mosby.
Okay.
And he's already eating.
Yeah.
And that's my dear wife.
Hello, Pinky. Ma'am.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Hello.
All right, let's go inside.
Yeah.
Right, Dr. Sandeep, Dr. Pinku, thank you for having us at your place. It's lovely out here. We've had a long conversation through the day, so I throw this question to Dr. Pinku. We've known Dr. Sandeep as a surgeon, as a professional, but let's talk about Dr. Sandeep as a person. So who else but you to talk about him?
So he's a very simple, humble, loving person. Yeah, I mean, very easy to live with.
Right. So talking about living with, I mean, he was earlier mentioning how you are his, source of strength and support, and everything that he's probably achieved in his life is all down to the support that he's had from you. So how about, you know, managing your own career, his career, home? So the difficult choices that you had to make, the journey that you've had with him. So if you can talk about that.
I mean, we just went with the flow. As the opportunities keep coming by, we try to see if it's good or bad, and then accordingly kind of pick it up and go with the flow. So there was no basic element of sacrifice or doing something extraordinary. What needed to be done at that particular point, we just went ahead and did it. And having a non-ambitious person as a partner always helps. I had no major ambitions in life. I mean, I'm not a go-getter or a very outgoing person. So I was happy the way things came my way. When I had a good career option, I worked very hard and I succeeded. It was mainly I had a good practice in Dhaka, Bangladesh, and second time it was very good at Gurgaon, Delhi. So those two places, Fortis Hospital mainly, we did very well. Personally, I did very well. But again, in Chennai, I'm having a little relaxed time. So it's good, and I take it in the stride the way it comes.
It needed a lot of sacrifice. I mean, she's given up. I mean, she's
but it was all needed, you know. It was just the time, the situation.
Your interests at home, with one another, what do you guys like doing in your downtime?
As you can see, he's an antique collector, so he keeps bringing old pieces. We sit and clean them up and kind of arrange them and fix the house.
Yeah. Then it's beautifully done.
Yeah, so it's all his creation. I just support him in whatever way he wants. Then personally, I like doing a lot of cooking. And I like to cook myself. Never really had a servant cooking for us.
Sure.
So gardening, growing vegetables. And we have two wonderful boys. One is in Singapore.
Okay.
So whenever he comes home, he gets all the attention. And the second one is perennially attention seeking.
So mother's boy always.
Mother's boy. Yeah.
You spoke about cooking, and Dr. Sandeep, when he is as fit as a fiddle. So is that the secret of his fitness?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, that is. I would take credit for that. 100%. Yeah, I see to it that what he eats is
for the discipline that she is
very well proportioned and very well thought about. Yeah.
Sure.
The quality of the meal, nutrient
content, no junk, you know, and timely, absolutely timely instructions to consume food.
Yeah, you have an antique schedule, so you need somebody to.
All that is her.
Sure. And you spoke about gardening. You have a beautiful garden. We just got a glimpse of as we walked inside.
Yeah.
So is that all you and?
No. That is just the gardeners here. They came with the house, so they do a wonderful job. But I grow vegetables and do my own little bit here. And
right. So talking of the gardens and the lawns, Dr. Sandeep, would it be fine if we just take a stroll outside and continue this conversation and take it outside from here?
Sure, perfect.
Thank you, ma'am, for joining us.
Yeah. Thanks.